Here we're going to practice evaluating some definite integrals using the second fundamental theorem of calculus. So here we have the definite integral from 1 to 3 of 4x cubed dx. Okay, so what is the second fundamental theorem of calculus says? So what it tells you is how to evaluate a definite integral, something like this. And what you do is essentially find the antiderivative of whatever function this is inside your integral, and then evaluate it at the upper bound, subtract, and then evaluate it at the lower bound. Okay, so let's practice this on this function. This is a pretty simple function, so we can see how the process works. So I'm going to start by taking the antiderivative of 4x to the third. Okay, so here you need to remember your antiderivative rules. But basically this 4, and actually maybe it'd be helpful if I rewrite it like this. The 4 is a constant multiple, so I can just leave it out front. So then this becomes 4 times, and then if I take the antiderivative of x cubed, that's x to the 4th over 4. Okay? And that's the antiderivative, but kind of the new thing here is that I'm going to be evaluating this from 1 to 3, and this is the notation we usually use, this bar, and then a 1 and 3. Well, this simplifies, right? This is x to the 4th from 1 to 3. So then to evaluate this, I'm going to start by plugging in 3. So you always start by plugging in the upper bound. So that's 3 to the 4th. Minus, and then you plug in the lower bound, 1 to the 4th. So 3 to the 4th is 81. 1 to the 4th is 1, so you end up with 81 minus 1, which is 80. So then 80 is the value of this definite integral. Here we have the definite integral from 0 to 1 of x minus 2 times 3 minus x. Okay, so we know that the process we have to follow is to take the antiderivative and then evaluate at the bounds. But this particular expression doesn't really fit any of our known antiderivative rules. But we can easily remedy that fact just by FOILing out this expression. Okay. So if I FOIL this out, then I get 3x minus x squared minus 6 plus 2x. And then I can combine terms. So this becomes 5x minus x squared minus 6 dx. Now this is something that I can use my antiderivative rules on, right? Because these are just powers or constant multiples, so all things I know how to take the antiderivative of. So if I do that, right, I'm going to start by taking the antiderivative of 5x. Well, the 5 is a constant multiple, so it can just stay out front. Then if I take the antiderivative of x, I get x squared over 2. Okay, so 5x squared over 2. Minus, okay, so for x squared, if I take the antiderivative, I'm going to get x cubed over 3. Minus, and then minus 6x. The antiderivative of 6 is 6x. But I'm evaluating this, right, from 0 to 1. So my final answer is going to be a number. So what I do then is I start by plugging in 1 to this entire expression. Okay, so you want to make careful use of parentheses and brackets to help you out when you're doing this. So I'm going to plug in 1 first. Well, plugging in 1 is pretty easy, right? So in this first term, if I plug in 1, I'm just going to get 5 halves. And then minus 1 third, minus 6. Okay, so that's all plugging in 1. And then I subtract and plug in 0. But plugging in 0 to this expression is just going to give me 0. So I just end up with 5 halves minus 1 third minus 6. And if you work that out, that should give you a final answer of negative 23 over 6. Okay, so that's the final answer to this definite integral, which is the net area under this function on this interval from 0 to 1. Here I have the antiderivative of a sort of messy looking function. So the antiderivative of 1 to 2 of 2x minus the square root of x all over x squared. None of my basic antiderivative rules are going to help me out here, right? I don't know how to take the antiderivative of a quotient, but I can rewrite this expression so that I can use my known antiderivative rules. And the way you do that in a situation like this is by splitting up the fraction. Okay, so any time that you have multiple terms in the numerator of a fraction, you can split up the fraction. Okay, so if I split up this fraction, it's going to look like this. 2x over x squared minus square root of x over x squared. So it's like subtracting fractions, but just going backwards. I'm unsubtracting the fractions. And I can do a little simplification, right? I can reduce each of these. So the first fraction becomes 2 over x. Okay, now my second fraction, I have x to the 1 half on top, x squared on the bottom. So overall, that's going to give me x to the 3 halves on the bottom if I reduce that. Okay, now I'm going to go just a little bit further. I'm going to write this as 2 times 1 over x minus x to the negative 3 halves. And I'm just doing that to make it a little bit easier to see how our antiderivative rules apply in this situation. Okay, so now we're ready to take the antiderivative. So the first term I have is 2 times 1 over x. Well, the 2 is a constant multiple, okay, so it can just hang out front. But I want the antiderivative of 1 over x. And if you remember, okay, that's a special rule, and that's actually the natural log of the absolute value of x. And then for the second one, well, this is just a power rule. Minus x, so I add 1 to the power, so that's going to become a power of negative 1 half divided by negative 1 half. And I'm going to be evaluating this from 1 to 2. All right, so let's clean up that second term. So this is minus a negative value, so positive. I'm dividing by a fraction, so that's the same as multiplying by its reciprocal. And then I have this negative power in the top right. So if I kind of simplify all those things at once, this becomes plus 2 over square root of x. And I'm evaluating this from 1 to 2. At this point, I can go ahead and plug in my limits. So I'm going to begin by plugging in 2 to this expression. So if I do that, I get 2 natural log of 2 plus 2 over the square root of 2. Then I'm going to subtract, and I'm going to plug in 1 at this point. Okay, so if I plug in 1, I get 2 natural log of 1 plus 2 over the square root of 1. At this point, I can see if I can clean this up, clean this expression up at all. So in my case, I have 2 natural log of 2 plus 2 over root 2. There's not much to do in those first two terms. But then I have minus 2 natural log of 1, but the natural log of 1 is just 0. And then I have minus 2 over the square root of 1, which is just going to be 2. So minus 2. I could factor out a 2 if I wanted to, and have 2 times the quantity natural log of 2 plus 1 over root 2 minus 1. And this is the value of my definite integral in this case. All right, here we have a trig antiderivative. So to do this, we need to remember our rules for the antiderivative of trig functions. So specifically, if you're taking the antiderivative of cosine ax dx, that's going to equal 1 over a sine of ax plus c. Now, of course, in this case, we're not going to have the plus c because we're doing a definite integral. But this is the form, right? This is the form of the antiderivative. So if we apply that here, right, my a is 2, right? I have cosine of 2x. So then the antiderivative is 1 half sine of 2x. And I'm going to evaluate from 0 to pi over 4. Okay, so I start by plugging in pi over 4. So 1 half sine of 2 times pi over 4. Okay, that's all inside the sine. Minus 1 half sine of 2 times 0. Well, that's just 0. Okay, so 1 half sine, this is pi over 2 if I simplify, minus 1 half sine of 0. Well, sine of pi over 2 is 1, hopefully you remember. So 1 half times 1 minus and sine of 0 is 0, so minus 0. So my final answer just ends up being 1 half for this definite integral.